हेलो।
हेलो शर्मा सर। हेलो
गुड
हेलो,
आफ्टरनून।
गुड आफ्टरनून सर। आई एम प्रणव स्पीकिंग।
हेलो, हाउ आर यू? वेरी
हाँ फाइन सर, फाइन। हाँ
गुड।
या हाउ इज द वेदर सर ओवर देयर? ओह यस यस सर,
वेरी बैड वेदर।
या हियर आल्सो सेम वेदर इज नॉट गुड।
या हियर इट इज टू हॉट।
या we are waiting for our vice chancellor sir. He is joining.
Yes.
बोलो मैंने देखा था।
very good afternoon to one and all. Honorable Vice Chancellor of our university, Professor Kandapa Das sir, respected university officials, director of schools, esteemed participants being here across the country and around the world, and faculty members of KKHSOU and the academic counselors of our university. We, the discipline of education under Surya Kumar Bhuiyan School of Social Science, Krishnakanta Handik State Open University, is very much privileged to organize a 3-day international workshop to be held from today, that is 29th of July to 31st of July, on design, develop, and implement effective online teaching. Our Vice Chancellor always insists us to develop such kind of new techniques in the field of teaching learning. And by his initiative, under his leadership, we tried to organize this workshop on the theme design, develop, and implement effective online teaching, only to adopt and adapt ourselves in the emerging field of online teaching learning. We, as an academicians, always keen for acquiring new knowledge, new skills, which will develop the field of teaching learning activity to another height. With this end in view, we thought that in this workshop, we will try to brush up our existing knowledge for online teaching in another way. Hopefully, our experts will meet the expectations of all the academicians who participated in this workshop to learn something new in the online teaching learning activity or teaching learning field. We are happy to announce that there are many international participants who joined in our workshop from Bangladesh, from Malaysia. Hopefully the participants of Sri Lanka will join, and the other Indian open universities. Our academic counselors are also very much interested to join this workshop to learn the new pedagogy of online learning. With these few words, now I would like to request our Honorable Vice Chancellor Sir, Professor Kandapa Das Sir, to formally inaugurate our workshop with his inaugural speech. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. So very good afternoon to all of you. It is indeed a privilege for me to be a part of this international workshop. I am in fact delighted to see Dr. Ramesh Sharma, who has been an old friend of mine and is a well-known expert in online learning in the world, I could say, not only in the country, who has been in this field for last so many years. So I am really delighted to see him as a resource person for this workshop. I'm also delighted to know that we have many international participants from Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, and Malaysia. In fact, I'm happy to see our old friends from Bangladesh, Dr. Sabina Yasmin, Mizanur Rahman, and few others whom I know personally for so many years. In fact, maybe more than a decade. And it is really heartening to get the privilege of to inaugurate this workshop, international workshop, which I personally feel is very relevant in today's context. As our colleague has mentioned that during the last 2-3 months, especially after the lockdown, and during the lockdown, I have been insisting with all meetings with my colleagues, especially with the faculty members and the officers, that the post-COVID online learning, ODL learning, especially open and distance learning, will not be the same as it used to be before March. It is going to be a totally different picture, and we have to be really prepared for that. As regards to the conventional face-to-face education, I think we have all witnessed that due to the COVID-19 lockdown, due to the pandemic, the academic community in the universities and colleges and schools were forced to adopt the method of online teaching learning in absence of the regular classroom atmosphere. Since schools, colleges, universities were closed down, shut down for a long time, just to keep the door open for learning for the learner, the traditional universities, which I mean conventional face-to-face universities, tried to make up or cope up with a new situation, adopting the online mode of teaching learning. But while doing so, we have observed, and we have also been discussing in many platforms, in workshop, seminar, conferences, in social media, that what exactly is happening in the name of online learning and online teaching learning is sometimes not desirable. So if it is so, what do we want actually for online learning? When you mean online learning, online teaching learning, online teaching learning environment, what exactly we want? When you talk about pedagogical issues, then we should also spell out what are those pedagogical issues we should be concerned about while adopting the online teaching methodology or online teaching learning environment. Now, I personally feel the open universities all over the world has this responsibility to basically spell out and also try to sensitize our colleagues from the conventional universities and also colleagues in open and distance learning universities about the various pedagogical issues and other issues which we should be taking into account while adopting for online teaching learning methods. And we should also clarify and substantiate with our own experience and say that rare mimicry of a conventional classroom in front of a camera is not online learning, online teaching. So in this context, I have been telling my colleagues that the post-COVID situation, when you open up, when you go for counseling and supporting our students, supporting our learners by mentoring in various ways, the situation will not be the same. And I personally, Philip, and I think you'll agree with me, the next 6 months probably, or maybe for 1 year, the learner would be hesitating to come to the study center for online, for counseling sessions or something like that. So in that situation, if physical face-to-face counseling is not feasible in the present context, the only option is left for us is online counseling. And I personally must confess, and I think that is also maybe the case for many universities, if not for all, that during the last 4 months, not only the conventional universities are basically could not cope up with the new situation, new normal situation, though there are some efforts of adopting a new methodology of online learning, the students and learners of even open university distance learning institutions are basically left at their own without any support from the university and the institution. The learners are basically, though they are given the learning material at the beginning of the semester, but the support in terms of counseling and other mentoring what we are supposed to give is maybe, I personally feel, is missing in too many extent. So to compensate that, if we want to adopt and go for a new methodology of teaching learning and supporting the learner through online mode, definitely we have to equip ourselves. We should know all those issues what we talked about, the pedagogical and other issues which are connected with online learning. So in this connection, I have been taking initiative of organizing various capacity building workshop, seminar, workshop, brainstorming with our colleagues, sometimes also with other colleagues of traditional universities, so that these issues can be addressed in a proper manner. So this particular workshop is actually been organized in this context and in this direction. And I believe while organizing this workshop, my colleagues have taken into consideration that it is not simply question of only capacity building of the faculty members of KK Hendrik State Open University. It is also the question of capacity building of our larger fraternity in the whole country and also in the region. So that is why this particular workshop was organized, not only for our faculty, but also faculty members from our neighboring countries, all the countries from the Asian region, those who could participate and at least take part in the brainstorming of these issues. And we are fortunate that as an expert, as a resource person, we have with us prominent expert like Dr. Ramesh Sharma. I believe with his expertise and other resource persons, we have a galaxy of resource person for this workshop. This workshop will be very beneficial for our faculty members, not only of KK Hendrik State Open University definitely, and also for the other faculty members of the universities of these Asian countries like Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, Malaysia, and other countries. And I wish all the best to all the participants. I'm again very delighted to see my colleagues from Guwahati University who also are participating in the workshop. I could see some of them. I'm really happy. And I'm happy again, once again, mentioning that I'm happy to see our international colleagues and also participants from various other universities of the country. And I wish all the success for this workshop and formally declare this workshop to be inaugurated. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. And thank you for your enlightening speech. You have very rightly mentioned that this workshop will not only benefit the faculty of KK Hendrik State Open Universities, but the other faculties and our academic counselor, those who are from the regular mode, they can also apply the pedagogy of online learning in their in the regular mode also. Thank you so much, sir. Now I would like to request our co-convener, Dr. Pranav Soikia, to give a brief outline about the workshop. Over to you, Dr. Soikia.
Good afternoon to all, honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, respected university officials, directors, faculty members, esteemed participants from different parts of Asian continent. I welcome all of you to this three-day online workshop on design, develop, and implement effective online teaching. This particular workshop is organized in consultation with our Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, who actually wants to transformation in the traditional mode of counseling or teaching learning in the university. And he has taken many initiatives, and among many initiatives, this is one of the initiatives that we are taking for really going to practice online teaching and learning in the true sense. Definitely, I don't need to reiterate the relevance and importance of the online learning in the present context, including the COVID present COVID situation. Of course, with the advent of internet, and it revolutionized the inventions already, transform distance learning into e-learning or online learning or web-based learning. And present COVID situation also transform even the conventional system of education into online learning. So definitely online learning is our present and online learning is our future. Of course, there is lots of reservation, lots of criticism, lots of issues related with this introduction of online learning regarding social issues, technological issues, there is a pedagogical issues. Of course, issues are there, but there is a possibility is also there. And definitely, information and communication technology played a pivotal role in online learning, of course. And e-learning is facilitated or supported through information and communication technology, and it can be provided through as a supported learning, as a blended learning, or complete online learning. But one very critical things to be remembered is that whatever it may be, learning is the critical elements of it and the main objectives of online learning. That means whatever mechanism, whatever modes, whatever technology, whatever we have to we have adopted, they are all secondary. Primary is to make learning. That means effective learning. So with this viewpoint keeping in mind, we decided that only technological knowledge or computer expertise not make a person to be a successful online teacher. For that, he needs to know the science and arts of online learning. And that is for that we conduct this effective online learning or online teaching workshop for 3 days. And here we try to assemble people. We are not going for big crowd. We selectively invited people to this particular forum. We are also very choosy to select our resource person also. We are bringing the best person of the field to deal with the different topics we have fixed for this particular online workshop. We are taking into consideration the online learning environment, which is very crucial for really conducting an effective online teaching and learning. And how can these learning theories can be implemented in designing online learning environment? We are taking care of that particular things. And also we are taking care in this particular workshop, how can effective online teaching strategies can be made? And how can different asynchronous and synchronous communication tools can be integrated in online learning? And another important thing we are taking into consideration in this particular workshop is that student engagement, motivation, and classroom management strategies during online learning. This particular important things also we are taking into consideration under this workshop. And also finally, the last things, but not the least, the assessment and evaluation. How can we conduct online assessment and evaluation? So definitely 3 days is not enough to cover all the aspects of online learning, but we put our best efforts to bringing the all critical points related to effective online learning pedagogy. And also we try to bringing best resource person, and also we try to bring and we discuss thoroughly. So we design our workshop for 1 hour presentation for each resource person and half an hour discussion. So I request you all, during the deliberation of our resource person, whatever queries, whatever questions come into your mind, please you type in the chat box. And after 1 hour deliberations, one by one questions will be offered to our resource person, and he will be definitely, with his knowledge and wisdom, give you the best answers to deal with particular questions or solve these particular questions. With this, I welcome you all. Hopefully, we are definitely together making this workshop a successful one. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Soikia. Now, I'm taking the privilege to introduce our renowned expert on online learning, Professor Dr. Ramesh Chander Sharma, sir, who is presently working as an associate professor under School of Global Affairs and also an expert in the field of technology. His areas of expertise are e-learning, instructional design, open educational resources, teacher education, and so on. Dr. Sharma served as an associate professor of educational technology and learning resources in Wawasan Open University, Malaysia. He was also visiting professor for Brazil and Fiji. He also served as a director of Commonwealth of Education Media Center for Asia, SEMCA. He also served as director of Institute of Distance and Continuing Education in University of Guyana, South America. He also served as a regional director in Indira Gandhi National Open University. Besides, He had published numerous articles and books related to e-learning and online learning and many other such related areas. So we are very much honored to have you with us today as an expert for our international workshop, and we are looking forward for your presentation, sir. Over to you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Indrani. Nice to hear your voice. First of all, let me congratulate Professor Kandarpa Das again, because we are meeting face to face virtually now for taking over the reins of this great institution, the Krishna Kanta Handi State Open University. I always, you know, I have so many good friends there. I love, and in fact, I was remembering that I was regional director of IGNU at Shillong in 1996. I joined there on in March, and on 20th March we opened the IGNU regional center in Chandmari. I hope it is still there if they have not relocated it to some other place. But you know, it was, I had developed that habit of two things. I still consider Shillong as the best place in the world, not only in India. I like it very, very much. And the other thing which I noted, that if I come from there to Delhi, I can't stay because the weather is so good. So, and I note that my very good friends are also present. I could see Vinod for a little short time, then he switched off his video. So thank you so much for remembering me for this important workshop. Actually, I believe that you know, I am remembered of my journal, Asian Journal of Distance Education, in which for the July issue we had our editorial, and in that, if you go there, then we have quoted two important personalities in our editorial. The first one is Marshall McLuhan, who says that with online or offline collections, it has proved that the world is a global village, and that has become very true. The another quotation which we have used there is by Lawrence, who in 1972, long back, at that time said there that a butterfly flapping in Asia can cause hurricanes around the world. And I think he said it 1972, but it proved even after 20 years, when a small microorganism which we cannot see with our own naked eyes has brought whole of the world to a halt. And due to that, we are in a very unique situation now. There have been disruptions to education previously, but this situation is completely unique. Nobody was ready. In fact, once I was discussing with some of my friends, and we thought that normally during the interviews, the people have a tendency, means the people who are the interviewers, they have the tendency to ask this question from the candidate, that where do you see yourself after 5 years or after 10 years? So we were thinking that if somebody has asked that question in 2015, and whatever the reply they have given at that time, they all have been proved wrong, because nobody could have imagined that after 5 years, where they will be or what they will be doing. So that is quite interesting. Let me share my screen so that I plan to go in this way because of from some of the points which Professor Kandarpa has indicated, I could relate to it. So I will make a little brief presentation, and after that we will, I want to share you some live websites on to go online and how to teach there. What are the various things which we need to be following from there? So let me just start my screen. I think very soon you will be viewing it. Okay, so here it is. I won't spend more time on it describing everything, but there are certain important challenges. Is that during it all started in December 2019, just last year, now around 6-7 months older. But this kind of pandemic, it has brought whole of the world to a halt. including education. Most of the, means almost all the institutions, they have, you know, stopped. And definitely due to the warnings by WHO and other various national health the agencies, that this is really a serious issue, and we should be taking care that how we move, where we move, and these interruptions to education, they are really unique this time, because there have been wars, there have been earthquakes or other things, but to such a global level, even during world wars previously, these things. Okay, very good. Somebody is quite excited of doing annotations on the screen. So nice to see that you are using the technology to that extent. But this has brought out a certain parameter with us, which we call it as the emergency remote education. Why? Because there has been a drastic change in how teaching and learning are happening. When the learners are physically out of school and separated from their teachers and co-learners. These educational practices currently during this, we are denoting them with different terms, and particularly in different countries. Somewhere we are saying distance education, e-learning, online education, homeschooling, etc., etc. But actually these terms, they do not quite capture what is being practiced due to the interruptions of education, which are better called as emergency remote education. And considering the terms being used in different context, the remarkable difference between the emergency remote education and distance education, which we feel, is that the latter is an option, whereas the former is an obligation. And such an understanding is crucial, because misconceptions in definition would lead us to misconceptions in practices if we don't understand it in a proper way there. And this has brought out certain interesting scenarios around us. I'm showing you these two photographs on the screen right now, where you see it. One is on the to the left is the building next to our place here in Delhi, the society. We are plot number 3, and this is plot number 4. If you see it in the on the first floor, there is a person in some yellow shirt there. He is the teacher, and perhaps he is mathematics teacher. And in all the above, you see some people. They are parents and students there. What he does every evening around 5 o'clock, he will come to his balcony and use a mini megaphone, the mini loudspeaker kind of thing, and he will teach the students mathematics there. So and at that time he will announce, and the parents and the kids, they will attempt those things, and then they will raise their hand and he will ask them, and the people from their own balcony, they will reply to that. The another one is the classical case of Jharkhand, where it was found that since there is no internet, so the municipality, along with some of the teachers, came up with a unique idea of putting loudspeakers there in the colonies, and the students, they were receiving their education. Just now I think I have received a message that the HRD ministry is now education ministry. Perhaps they have renamed it. It might have been announced on the television. So let's hope that with the renaming of HRD ministry as education ministry, perhaps because this is now a very crucial time for all of us. So and there are so many things that how do we teach during this pandemic times, how do we conduct online assessment at present? That is the real need, because the new session is coming up, and the final year students, those who are in their final semester or somewhere, who will be either shifting to the next level of their education, say from graduation to post graduation, or seeking some job, the conducting their examination is really one of the important things. We need to take care of that. And this is here about how are we conducting this remote online education, where it's not only a geographical separation of learners and teachers, but more importantly, it is a pedagogical concept. And the crash nature of emergency remote education, it has indicated certain weaknesses and strengths in our system, that how we can cope up in this situation when it happens from there. And although even the World Bank, they highlighted that during the emergency remote education, failure is common. Success is often a result of experience and learning from the past failures. That is very important, because, and there are so many issues of inequity, front, back, and center, all. And we need to prepare for this kind of thing, having some sort of a multimodal responses, capitalizing on existing infrastructure, utilizing a combination of different learning mediums to ensure that the students are engaged and learning happens. And this emergency remote education has been found to be a way which can ensure that students continue learning through a variety of avenues. Whether you see the kids in the Jharkhand, they are sitting in the streets, or various other means, like we who are in a better position can access internet sitting in our comfort of our homes from there. But the education systems in low or middle income countries, they are education institutions at schools or colleges, or children, students, teachers, the lack of high speed broadband, digital devices, they are really a certain kind of options which we need to take care from there. But these things, they are leading to these kind of different dimensions also. They are the issues of concern in relation to the interruption of education, and particularly the kind of trauma. I remember the saying by one of the vice chancellor of the University of Free State in South Africa, who said that our biggest mistake would be to treat our children as the cognitive machines, which can be simply switched on and switched off, after the trauma. And that's why you must be noting that almost all the webinars nowadays, or the conferences which are being conducted, what will be happening post-COVID in nature, how the things they will be moving along with it. And then there are many, a great deal of anxiety is going on. I have some videos with me which are quite funny kind of videos, in which I think nowadays you must have seen also on WhatsApp or Facebook. There is a picture of this granny, the nanny. She is writing on the notebook of the kid, and the kid is just lying inverted position on the bench, and the computer monitor has the teacher teaching it there. So the parents are taking care of the things there. This is bringing the anxiety in all. Students, they are anxious. Teachers, they are anxious. Parents, they are anxious. And everybody is having that thing. And then there are other issues also. Normally we talk of the technology things, but then there are other things also, like nowadays, perhaps means Assam and Bihar, or I'm sure maybe in Jharkhand also, that the flood has caused really havoc there. And it's such a distressed state of not only education, the health and the safety of the people there. And this added to the situation where various universities, due to this pandemic, both at local level and an international level, they asked their students who were staying in the hostels or university premises, vacate them, and on a very, very short notice, and they didn't have any place to go anywhere. So lack of information, lack of inconsistent information. There somebody saying something, somebody saying something. Today this order, next day another order. It's all, you know, so much of the problem. This situation showed us another dimension of the emerging educational role of parents. And now the parents, in addition to their own working life, their own work, need to take care of the educational role, because the kids staying at home now. Definitely we can't send them outside home for safety purpose, but then they have to assume, and particularly how they are trying to, you know, support their families, support the education. It has brought out a new dimension of in what way the education is going into there. And this has raised a kind of a supporting community where the tools and the knowledge, they are freely shared, and we are listening to different voices. You may be, you must have noted that the Google Meet, the Google company, they made the Google Meet freely accessible to all, even on personal Gmail IDs. Although that facility, perhaps so far as the company had announced, will be available to us till September, unless our bhai Sundar Pichai will not extend it after September. Then you might be remembering that various other software companies also, including Zoom, because in free version they gave it around 40 minutes. There they increased the duration of more than 40, even 1 hour or something like that. But then they have reverted back there. But during that pandemic time, many of the software solution companies, they offered there to the teachers, to the students, so that our education is not interrupted. And again, you must have seen that there are so many webinars going on around us, so many, even Coursera and those MOOC platforms during this time, they also offer that if you want to, you know, enrich your knowledge, want to acquire certain skills, they made their courses free. Means within that, okay, if you want, then you will be given certification, which otherwise in other condition, we need to pay for that. And I know many people in my circle, they acquired those skills, underwent those courses from Coursera, Udacity, and other places, so building there. This has given rise to a pedagogy of which Professor Kandarpa was highlighting in his introductory remarks about the pedagogy of care, affection, and empathy. Because this is a period of of human existence, and the resulting anxiety and trauma that we as learners, as teachers, as parents are experiencing, this pedagogy of care, it has surfaced within educational institutions to a very great level. Means while it was popularized there, but it is a crucial element. Means it needs to be always there, not only during this time. That how are we going to support our students? With this, one of the factors which we can consider is this Lambert's 6 critical dimensions model. And it means, what does it highlight? What does it signify is that it incorporates the learner's diversity and the agency into online and blended learning processes, along with having an understanding of the students' skills, support, learning materials, which empowers. There is a difference between them. Either we are reinforcing some knowledge into our students, or we are empowering them to be, say, builder of knowledge, creator of knowledge, or something like that. And for that, the various strategies or practices, such as flexibility with the course requirement, promptness, clarity of communication, multiple point of contact, personal connections, the reciprocity of caring, and student-centered design and teaching practices, they have been found to be quite effective. And that's why if you see that nowadays, you must have heard that name of DIY, that is do it yourself. Similarly, a concept is rising now, although it has been there and there are many researches which have proved. In fact, long back, once Mr. Bill Gates, the founder of Microsoft, he was interviewed and the people asked them that, what do you think of the future of education? And he said that the personalization of education would be the future of education. And this personalization of education is deeply related to the self-directed learning, that what I find myself. And this is very easy nowadays because we have so many of the technological solutions with us. I remember in Times of India, the newspaper, there was a famous cartoon. There is this building of a school and there is a mother, and the mother is pulling the child towards the school and child is not going. And he's saying that, Mama, why do I need to go to school when Google can tell me anything? And you see the power here, that I know there are many educational institutions, the schools, where the teachers or the administration, they have installed those Alexa devices. And that definitely, we don't know everything. And so we are not supercomputers that everything can be stored in our mind. Our knowledge is limited. We don't know many things. But with the help of these devices, the students, the teachers, they interact, and then they can, you know, answers and solutions to certain issues from there. This has brought out another, a sort of a thing which we are nowadays highly concerned with, that about the alternatives to assessment and evaluation. And there seems to be certain kind of a reasonable adjustment we have found, particularly during our study of 35 nations. It was a collaborative project. We requested some of the international authors to share with a two-page note on what are the challenges in education they are facing and what are the alternatives they are adopting. And during that, in that research, we have found that there is a greater shift to formative assessment now as compared to the summative assessment. And you may be knowing that many of the institutions, not only institutions, even countries, they have said that either no examination, we will just upgrade it, or for 1 year, no examination or something, or we will promote you on the basis of your internal assessment, which have been so far. And that's why this means, prior to this COVID, the formative assessment involved classroom observation or continuous feedback on homework or assignments. But now, although this assessment, now it is done at a distance. We use both synchronous as well as asynchronous mode. During your, now we are in synchronous mode using any of the tool, or asynchronous mode using any of the learning management system. We ask our students to perform certain activity or there. So many of the institutions nowadays, they have this policy of reasonable adjustment for accommodating learners with certain sort of disability also. So that has found a new dimension in our practices. And this, what has resulted into it, that certain sort of a issue of surveillance or ethics or data privacy concerns for it, because everything is going online. And means we don't have much of the choice also in what platform we can choose, or the digital footprints we are leaving behind. So means if you want to install any application on your mobile or install a software, the first thing which the software will ask us to agree to their terms and conditions. If you say no, you can't install that app. Means it will go there like that, something. And I found it very interesting, one thing. Very recently, JioMeet, it was launched as our own Indian web conferencing tool. When I was trying to install it on my mobile phone to test it, we tested it in a group, and we have mixed responses. On some cases, it was installed okay. It asks for its app to be used. So we there. And when I was reading its terms and conditions, there was one condition to which it was asking me to say yes to that, that it may edit my contact list. Now, accessing the contact list is okay, I can understand that. But editing the contact list, I could not imagine that. What was the purpose? Why you want to edit my contact list? Maybe say, for example, do you want to rename Dr. Pranab Saikia as Dr. Pranab Sharma or something? Why do you want to edit? So there are these certain kind of challenges. And then another thing is happening that we are now, if you are using Google Meet, and now we are conducting this session on Zoom, but if you try Google Meet nowadays, and in Google Meet, when you start recording the session, a message flashes on your screen. It asks you that if you are recording the screen, it is presumed that you have the permission of your participants to record the session, because their photograph, their video, or whatever they say, it will be recorded. So that is an ethical and a privacy issue which is coming. And now you may be seeing on social media by various people, means we as teachers also, every day we are putting our we asking our students that, okay, because the photograph is going to be displayed on the screen, and identity theft, cyber crimes, etc., etc., whole lot of things they going on. But there is another dimension to that also of digital inequality. And means most of the everybody is dependent on access to internet in addition to the data and the services provided. And this is an interesting thing which is happening now. That's why the Jharkhand example has been found to be unique in a way. No internet, no problem. We are going to teach you through loudspeakers. But you must have seen those recommendations of ministry that for primary school, not more than class on 30 minutes, and for higher, then the difference going on. So much, how much long time you would want? Every day on a normal data package, we get 1.5 GB of data. And if we ask our students to join our online webinar in real times, that goes away within 1 hour. After that, what happens? What do you do? You get more package for the next class and everything like that. Means these things. So this inequality, it is arising to a very large extent in the areas. Somewhere, okay, somewhere the situation is really. And it has been found that it is not only just there, it had certain deep roots into the material, the cultural or historical inequalities which resulted into this geopolitical there. So, but it has given certain opportunities also during this lockdown. The openness related to the initiatives, they have proved the values which has played a very significant role. The biggest silver lining in this pandemic has been one, a turn towards open educational resources and open educational practices, because the many people, they came forward to share their resources, to share their knowledge, to share their practices, collaboration increased, and at all levels, be it school level or at university level. But this needs not to be confused with the free content that is made available temporarily by publishers or software things. Ultimately, they are going to stop at a particular time because they cannot keep on going something free, of course, like Zoom. Initially, they allowed the free version, free account, more than 40 minutes you can go, but maybe not. Similarly, the other softwares from there, how they can go into it. But this has another dark shadow also during the pandemic, when the cases of the various kind of violence, and particularly it impacted the adolescent girls and women in what is known as the shadow pandemic, which the UN has highlighted it many times. And then there has been many, because of the schools closed, everybody staying at home, and there have been many reports of an increase in gender-based violence, teenage pregnancies, child marriages, exploitation, other kind of abuse there. So, And there is one, this Global Chip of Education, GPE. It has warned that this impact of COVID, it is going to surpass that which was caused by even Ebola pandemic from there. And in these conditions, then the schools or the parents or what, they need to assume a different role so that these things they can be taken care of. It has given another identity or an opportunity for us to upgrade our skills and competencies to survive in this time of crisis from there. And I'm reminded of two, three people, like you may be knowing about Elon Musk. He famously very recently said that the college is for fun. Means we don't go to college for, for degree. And he says that I don't bother about degree. If you don't have degree, but if you can my work, I will hire you. And similarly, Google has also announced that for jobs, the degree is not the essential condition. In addition to that, how can we differentiate the various kind of skills between the real news and the fake news, those kind of skills, how to use the technological tools to a good extent, not only for the means we presume that the generation X and generation Y, they are more tech savvy than the older generations, but definitely means having just born into that, still we need certain skills and competencies which are very much essential for us to know about it. Because if you are hitting the ground running, still there may be some information which is very good for us to go into this field. So this brings us to a certain kind of online pedagogies or things which we need to be aware of. So I am now going live on the website. Oh, I think I may need to share my screen again. And I will also check that if there are any questions. Okay, where is there? So you will see my screen very soon. Okay. So if we have to go, there are certain things which I follow regularly. That one of the things, although we consider that nowadays our students, our younger generation is very much they are very much tech savvy, but still there are certain things which we need to be aware of, either we are teachers or we are students, and that is the fundamentals of web or the fundamentals of technology. In that case, still there are many people, perhaps I'm not sure how many are aware that there are certain netiquettes how to behave in online environment. So for that, there are certain interesting things. And in this light, this is an interesting course by BBC about the, about the internet, how does it work, what is URL, how to use email, about computers, those things. They are quite interesting thing which we need to be telling our students about it so that they can make a good use about it. Once we are there, then the next thing which I believe is very important for us is to remain knowledgeable about the trends, what is happening around us and where we are leading. Say, for example, if we are talking about the programming field, it is better to learn that language which will be in the future. Because, and particularly like there are two revolutions which are happening around us. One is this fourth IR, the industrial revolution, which was suggested by Swash Klaus, the president of World Economic Forum. There is another thing which is happening around us. We call it fourth educational revolution. There is a book by, I think this one will be the book. Yes, you can. You are seeing the photograph of it. Yes, by Anthony Sheldon. This is very important book. That how the AI is going to affect us in near future. So it is very important for us. Currently, we are in this era when we are passing through these two revolutions, fourth industrial revolution and fourth education revolution that is going on. So for that, what we can do that, okay, I will keep on opening new tabs, and later on I will show you a utility on how you can save all of them together. So there are few important resources which we should be aware of as a teacher. One is this Horizon report. This Horizon report, initially it was till last year, the New Media Consortium, which is sort of a non-profit organization, was publishing it. But now it has been, you know, taken over by EduCause. And I am an expert member into this group. This is very interesting report, and I hope that my friends at KKHSOU are aware of this New Media Consortium, the Horizon report. Here we understand technology in various ways. What are the emerging educational technologies? What are the challenges of education technologies, and what are the problems which we are facing? And we divide them into three groups. 1 to 2 years, what is with us, what is going to happen, what is happening now, what will be within next 2 to 3 years, and next 4 to 5 years. And every year we try to find, this is the latest report, and this is free report. You can download it from there. The PDF is available and you can read it. And every time we try to find out that what next is coming up, or how the education is taking shape, what is emerging from there. So first we need to, so this is the first dimension. You may be knowing that TPEC model by Punya Mishra, the technology, pedagogy and content, how they are associated with that. So this deals with the technology, but along with the technology, very important is pedagogy. How do we should be aware about what are various pedagogies, because the pedagogies, they change with the era in which we are. You know, you must have heard about various theories of learning, like Pavlov theory, behaviorism, constructivism, those various kind of theories, hit and trial, cause and effect theory, etc., etc. But depending on the time era in which we are, at that time, when these things, they used to be there, there was no internet. Mostly it was face-to-face. Now we have internet. We are going completely virtual. The things, there is a different kind of pedagogies. These are emerging. What is the source for them? There is a very good source of innovative pedagogy. You can click it, and this is the report which is also published by UKOU. You may be knowing that the first open university of the world, and particularly IGNU is based on the model of UKOU. You have three-tier system: headquarter, regional center, and study centers. The headquarter is the decision-making body, regional centers are the implementation body, and the study centers are the grassroots level student support services centers there. You can see that every year, 2020, 2019, 2018, 7, 6, 5, 4, every year, the pedagogy is discussed here. Say like there, I don't know how many of you are aware about, say, geo-learning, learning analytics, seamless learning, learning from gaming, or badges to accredite, MOOCs, rebirth of academic publishing, seamless learning, rhizomatic learning. You may be remembering that there was a famous MOOC on rhizomatic learning offered, and many people there. So you have bring your own device, you have learning design informed by analytics, massive open special learning pedagogy, context-based learning, computational thinking, which is very much essential if we have to get artificial intelligence ready. Computational thinking, analytics of emotions. Are you aware about stealth assessment? What is stealth assessment? you know, these are the pedagogies which are emerging, the innovations, the experiments, they are done on that, and then those which are successful, they are carried forward, otherwise they are upgraded and updated from there. So this is pedagogy. Now another thing here which has been highlighted on many theses, many and the pedagogy, say like if you read it here, that formative analytics or learning from the crowd means big numbers, and wherever if you go you will find the analytics word many there. This has given rise to the field of big data analytics, and this is very crucial, very important. See, like our Kakahandik Open University, it has been exist for quite some time now, and it has lot of data with us, but how to process data? We have the data, but what is meaning of that data? How do we come to know about it? And you may be knowing the world authority on that, George Simmons. So they have this Society for Learning Analytics, SOLAR, and they conduct conference also. They have their own research journals and others. The Journal of Learning Analytics is also there. This is a good site to be, you know, seen here. And we know this there in the session now, I know. He's an expert on learning management systems also. Our learning management system, it generates wonderful data, lot of data into it. But if with the help of that, can we make our data, you know, talk to us? That will give us new insights. I forgot the name of that person who said that, but there is a famous quotation by someone. You can make a Google search on that. He said that if we torture the data enough, it will confess. This is a very interesting statement about data. If we torture the data enough, it will confess. What does that mean? That the data can tell us unique things. And that is very easy. Nowadays, many of the learning management systems, we implement XAPI. So you can say, XAPI. XAPI is the experience API, you can see, yeah, this is XAPI. This tells us that how the students, they are interacting with our content. It is not the click technology that who stayed on our page for how long. It can give us the qualitative insights into it, that how the students, they are interacting with our content, whether they are finding it useful, whether they are not finding. And for that, previously it used to be called as Tin Can API. Tin Can API. But nowadays, means it has been upgraded, Tin Can API. But currently we call it as XAPI, which is Experience API. So X, you can see here, this, and it is easy. It simply says that we create a statement and then integrate it into our content material. And then when the student, they access our content material, it sends us a statement back to our learning record store, LRS, and from where we can make the analysis of that. And this is the field of big data analytics, learning analytics. It is, it has become a very significant area, which is going into there. This combined with the area which is all around us, and you can silently thank Sir Tim Berners-Lee, who invented World Wide Webs around 30 years ago, that everything nowadays we have been using our mobile devices. So this is the world of mobile now. Most of your payments nowadays you do using your mobile device, because you can. We have the apps for education, for entertainment, for health. You go on morning walk and your just excuse me. I don't know who is calling me. These things. For that, you must check this UNESCO every year regularly organizes Mobile Learning Week. So this is the for the latest one, Mobile Learning Week. And here the new advancements on how the mobile is, this is the world of mobile now. Most of your activities we do using this. So what the people are doing, what they are learning from there, this is always a good idea to keep checking. And here you can see that the themes for the 2020 is about how the access to artificial intelligence and digital innovations, access to quality, enhanced learning outcomes, gender or the non-discriminatory, they will be using this. And these are the real issues of how in which we can, you know, we need to go about it. Now, you have now, you know, got ready for, if you are as a teacher, you think that you are ready for online teaching now for our students. There is, I mean, now we are forced, everybody is has gone online, but when things will become a little bit slow down or what, we should be checking about readiness for online learning, whether it is there or not. And there are certain, you know, standardized tools which are available with us. You must try this, like online readiness questionnaire. And if you see its license, this is by Penn State, released at Creative Commons license. So simpler, there are various statements into it. We just keep on, I'm at random, just like, you know, to show you. I don't know, somebody's calling me. Okay, just very quickly, I'm going through it here to show you that how does it gives you an idea about if you want to be successful in online medium, then what we need to be doing. So you, and then just click on am I ready, and here it gives you the analysis, self-direction, you need to set some strong goals for yourself, learning preferences, you need to stress your for different type of media, this, that, etc. What are your study habits? What are your technology skills, computer equipment capabilities, etc. This is a good resource which can be used by the teachers or even for your online program if you are going there. There is another website also, another link. I'll share these links with you. This is by Nassau Community College, and similarly, that thing there, I won't discuss it more. So this is there. Now, there are certain good resources available to us, which we, for all those who are involved in online teaching learning, it is a good idea to access them due to two reasons. They are very much useful to us. And secondly, they are, you know, highly relevant and free to access. One is maybe Professor Kandarpa and all our members know him because he is very dear to us. You, everybody may be knowing Professor Curtis Bonk. So this is his site called as Tech Variety. And this is a free ebook. You can download it. What is this Tech Variety? This name has, you know, two meanings into it. One of the variety of technology, you can say it, but otherwise they, main issue here which it discusses, which is very important part of pedagogy of online, is motivation. Motivation. You know, when you create a video, normally we advise, and that is the success of the Khan Academy videos, that their videos are on an average 8 to 12 minutes videos. And that's why we say that if you are creating a teaching video, don't make it a lengthy video. Of course, you can make a lengthy video. If you are ready to create a video which is of the quality of Bahubali movie, which you can again and again see for 3 hours nonstop, wonderful. Otherwise, education videos for more than half an hour, we believe that our attention or our motivation, it decreases because of various factors into it from there. So just a minute. So that goes with that. But here, what they have done, he has identified these areas. That's why it is called as the short of tech variety. So what should be the psychological safety, comfort, or sense of belongingness? The establishing a tone or a climate of connect, how to encourage, how to raise curiosity, what are various variety of activities we can do, how do we give autonomy to those relevance. So this resource, it discusses all these things which are quite important for us in for our online teaching learning. Another resource which I would recommend to you is by Athabasca University Press, a highly acclaimed book by Terry Anderson. Okay, I could have gone. Sorry. No. Let me go back, and here it is. This is book, Theory and Practice of Online Learning. This is an award-winning book, which perhaps has been translated into more than 60 languages of the world. And it discusses about the theory of online education development, infrastructure for that, how to design online courses, and its delivery and evaluation and there. And this is under Creative Commons. It can be reproduced, you can download it and use it for non-commercial purpose. Just don't forget to cite Terry Anderson. You can simply download this book from here, and that can go with that. Okay, so here, this is the thing which is related to that. Now, comes to the pedagogy for there, we have various tools or technologies to be available with us. One is the learning management system, a kind of a platform on which we will be mounting our courses on that. So we have these two kind of learning management systems, proprietary like Blackboard, or free or open source like Moodle, which is open source learning management system. Then there are a variety of platforms available. I'll just quickly show you the websites. Like we have Sakai with us, Sakai Learning Management System. So here it is, Sakai. Then we have Joomla. So this is again open source tool. You may be knowing about Moodle. Sorry. Moodle is there, which is open source and one of the very powerful system. Then we have Canvas by Instructure. So you can create your courses on that. Very recently, I offered a MOOC on cooperative learning pedagogy. We used this MOOC kit platform, which is by IIT Kanpur. And in our MOOC, it was a 4-week MOOC. We just had our first batch out from there. And we got around 4,800 registrations into it. And the success rate or the active participation was also very high in our course. So this is also another kind of platform which is used. Then you all may be knowing about say like Google Classroom. That is considered to be easy. So if you think that Google Classroom is easy than Moodle, I agree it is easy, but it is easy because it has less features. Moodle has more features. So it is something like if Google Classroom is like a bicycle, then the Moodle is like Ferrari. So you have. But if you think that Google Classroom is easy, I suggest that you try this Edmodo, which is even easier than Google Classroom. So it is coming up. This is Moodle Edmodo. And basically it is more popular at school stage. Then we have Schoology. So here it is, Schoology. So these are various learning management. My purpose of telling you, about this is so that you should be aware of that what kind of variety is available to you, and you can make a decision. All these platforms, they have certain unique properties to them. Means there are different advantages, there are certain limitations of every one of them. Then we have various kind of web conferencing tools available to us. You already know about, we are using Zoom. Then we have Google Meet. For web conferencing, you may be knowing about Cisco WebEx. So this is Cisco WebEx. Then there is one open source Jitsi. You can download this hands-on guide by going to my page, how to conduct online classes using Jitsi. And it's a free plugin is available even for Moodle. So that can be used from there. We have Zoom and Go to Meeting or Go to Webinar. They are also good platforms. They are nearly same. They have one difference with them that if you use them, Go to Webinar, the presenter window is also presented as a user window in a small window on your screen. So you from there you can check that what the users are seeing. Sometimes it happens that your screen is different and then users are not getting that screen. So that way it has certain, you know, different features with them. So these are various tools which we use in our there. Then we need media, various kind of media for our content, for our content creation and content delivery, for both these. And these kind of interactive medias, we use them, we create them in various ways. Say like, I'll show you, in our university, we have created audiobooks. Nowadays, the podcasts, they are getting very popular. And one of my friend, we are creating an online course on this area. And say, this is an anchor platform on the basis of which you can create your podcasts. And the podcast, you can listen to the podcast. Say, for example, if I play this, and let me say,
welcome to the Teacher Parv podcast series. We are meeting again to talk about professional development as well as about employability. We have already talked about what employability should be. It should not just be the hiring criteria, or it should not just be your eligibility. Or
so this way, you know, the audio messages we can create, and it has a various relevance. Low bandwidth, it can go because we can send it there and then can explain, then can have the interaction with our students. It can be used for assessment purposes, for explanations purposes, and like that. That goes with that. Then certain sort of interactive media in the form of, say, simulations. And this is one of the very popular site for having these FATE simulations. I'll just quickly say, for example, if you want to go for chemistry simulations. Okay, page is opening. And you can see that it is, these are all open source, freely available to you. and you can click on any of the animation. We can very well integrate them in our course. Say here you can download it and use it, or you can embed it in your learning management system. Even it gives you a ready-made option here to integrate it with your Google Classroom, or you can simply say that check it that how it works. So here you can reset it, you can add a balloon, or you can put it charge and bring it to the wall. And if you see that how the charge particles behave in a particular way and like that. So this way it can be used on how the things we can show to our students. So this kind of interactive media which is available to us. There are certain interactive games available to us, which we can, and there are simple tools also available which allow us to make them. Say for example here for food chains. And if you see, say for example, want to show them about who are the producers, consumers, and it runs on Flash. Oh, sorry, I need to share my another screen. You click on it, now you will be able to see. Okay, this has come, the interactive game, and it gives you the instructions. After that, it shows you that how producer, consumer, and the thing there. And we need to see what is the food chain. So here.
The food chain game. Play the game.
These are the instructions.
Number one, simple chain.
If you put it here.
Bird.
So you take.
Flower.
And then next food.
Caterpillar.
And who eats the caterpillar? So, so this way you can see that how the so and similarly you can
too easy number tie the next chain
bigger chain acorns snake
okay it is there
mouse
snake
hawk. Finished. On to the next chain.
So we can create those things. Let me go back to my screen. Here. Then there are other tools with the help of which we can create self-running courses. This course is on instructional design, curriculum design by my friend in Carnegie College, Canada. And this has been created using Articulate Storyline as a self-running course. So you can see this is about curriculum approaches for learning. I'll share this link. You can use it freely. So here, this is about 6 weeks free course on instructional design. And if you click on it here, it will show you about learning. What are their learning dimensions? What are the learning objectives and curriculum approaches? You click on it and then various other things, say like behavioral approaches. And then it has inbuilt exercises also into it at relevant places with the help of which we can use them with that. So these are certain things which we use from there. So we divide our content into, say, we call them as narrative media like podcast, interactive media like the simulations which I showed to you. The third category is communication media like social networks. So where the content is an output from the learning process. So we have various kind of discussion forums on the Moodle or in your Google Classroom. We have very online meetings, we have webinars, we have chat messaging. If you are using WhatsApp, this is an example of communication media. So here, how we can integrate it to make our teaching learning stronger for our course. The next variety is adaptive media, where content is an input to the learning process. In communication media, it is the output from the learning process, but in adaptive, it is the learning process. And say, for example, nowadays we are using AR, VR thing, something like that. Let me show you. I think Vinod and Prasanjit, when they visited me in Vavasan, they may immediately recognize this. Even Professor Kandarpa also. We have simple kind of tools with the help of which we can create these kind of 360 degree. This is the Vavasan University. I was sitting somewhere here on it. And this is the, and you can, you know, zoom it to a very high magnification. And you can say, go. And this is the building in which I was residing. So this is 360. Now, what is the educational implication of that? The educational implication of these kind of content is that we can, let me show you a real example of how we created that, means its significance. Almost we have covered whole of Delhi by capturing our historical heritage there and created as a 360 degree view of that, so that those students, those who are not able to visit there, they can, you know, visit those things. Say like this is Ghayasuddin tomb, and there are certain prompts if you click on there, and then you can remove, walk in any direction possible from anywhere. And these things, they can be created using simple tools. I created that for Vavasan Open University using this simple tool. It is called as Google Street View app. So you can download this app on your mobile phone. The only thing which you need to take care is that your phone should have a gyro sensor into it. And then, you know, it will show you you need to focus it on the spot, and then keep on clicking in one direction, say from left to right or right to left, and then top portion and then the earth portion, and it will accumulate everything from there. And similarly, we have intelligent tutorials, we have strategic games, we have adaptive learning pathways, which is very much important nowadays, because artificial intelligence is machine learning and deep learning. So deep learning is the core of that, which allows us to create adaptive learning pathways. Adaptive learning pathways is, maybe let me show you this good example. Perhaps I'm sure that you must have seen this movie on internet, particularly if you have Netflix at your home. This movie, Black Mirror Bandersnatch. If somebody has seen it, you may be knowing about it, this movie, if I may have some image of this movie from where, okay, let me go back and click on this image. And here you see what it does. When the movie runs, it offers you an option. It puts you into a certain situation and asks you select this or select that. And depending on what you select using your remote control, the story will proceed in that direction. So similarly, in teaching learning, we can have adaptive learning pathways where the content adapts to our learning needs from there. And there are artificial intelligence tools which allow us. And these are very helpful in online medium, because here the students, they are interacting with that and they're free to choose what is good for them. There, on the basis of that, that can be, you know, adopted. And the last kind of media which we consider is very important for us is the productive media. productive media, again, as an output from the learning process. Like we have Wiki, we have blogs, where the students, they are, you know, producing some content. So, and it can be, there are various apps with the help of which we can edit text, we can edit video, we can edit audio, we can edit slideshows, etc., or creating spreadsheets, something through the Wiki, through blog, or through our website, or through some kind of software adaptation from there that goes as the adaptive media from there. So I have told you around five kind of media. The first one was narrative media. Narrative media means like using the audio channels there, the podcast kind of thing, or infographics or animations making like Flotagon, Animaker, Powtoon, or those kind of things. Second is interactive media, like simulations from there, in which they use, or H5P. You may be knowing, let me show you H5P. HYP.org. And it offers you variety of things which we can create for our teaching learning process. And these are very easy to use in online medium. Let me show you a simple example of how we can, you know, use them and drag the country names. Okay, this one here, and let me post this link into the chat. You can use your here it goes. Oh, it is going to be known everyone. Okay, so I have just, if you can click on this link which I posted into the Zoom chat, you can work on this. And this is one of the variety in which you can simply ask your participants to drag and, you know, keep the name of the countries into the boxes, and how, you know, there then you can check what are the right answers or what are the wrong answers. Once you check it, and it shows you if the, it was right or it was wrong from there. So this you can create very easily from there. So this is interactive media. Then communicative media. Communicative media like your social networks, your online meetings, your webinars, your email messaging, your chat messaging from there. Then I told you about adaptive media, like augmented reality, virtual reality, those kind of things there. Intelligent tutorials, adaptive learning content, and the productive media. So these are certain pedagogical issues which we need to integrate with our teaching learning. And before I end, I think it is going to be a time so that we can have some time for question answer session also. There are certain tools which are very good for us. You may be knowing about Google Jamboard. Okay, it is here. As a whiteboard, which we use for our teaching learning. So you go to, and it is available to your Gmail account. Once you are there, you click on this, and from the apps package, you can find it somewhere there, where it is Google Jamboard. Similarly, Google Keep is a good place for you to keep all your links. It is safe there. It is available online. I also have a large a repository of my own links saved as Google Keep. So you can simply, if you check that, it will take you, and it is always synchronized with your, if you use them, then it will show you your all these things which you have used them, shared them, and all you can create so many labels, and accordingly everything you can keep on sharing. This is online. Anytime you can update it, you can access it. Similarly, this is Google Jamboard, which you can use at a online whiteboard thing by clicking on this button there, and then this is open. So you select your pen and whatever marker, and then you can, if you want to write something, you can write. You can want to erase it, you can erase, and then you can add a sticky note. You can save it, and then it can go something like that. Then from here, it can be shared with whom you want to share it with your, anyone, in the university or anyone with the link. And then whether they are editor or viewer, accordingly, you can copy the link and then can share it with your audience. Okay, there is a question, some convenient screen video recording tools. Okay, Prasanjit, I will come to that. So here, okay, this I have posted. But this is Google, but there is another one which I like much and it is more powerful than this. It is called as OAuth because of OAuth, it can be, we can embed it and it has more features than that. So you can just simply start drawing. You can write anything and then you can erase it using the eraser from there. Like you have color palette, so you can, you know, select a different thing. You can have a pen and then you can, if you want to draw some arrow indicating there. So this way, you know, there are straight line and then it allows you to have some squares. So you can, this is transparent one and this is opaque one. You can type using it there. And the beauty of this is that it allows you to upload your PDF, PPT or image file. So you click on it and it asks you what you want to upload it. So you click on upload and then it will ask you that what do you want to add to your here, and this is edit, which you can reposition and adjust it somewhere on your screen, anywhere you find it from there. This is it. Then once you think that you have there, so you can export as PDF or as image, high quality image, high quality there, and you can invite your students by copying this link. Or I like this embedding thing. You copy this and embed it in your LMS. And it works really wonderful from there. So this is about sharing this one. Now, Prasanjit is asking about some kind of screen recording tool. I will suggest you, today is 29th. I think today is the last day. If you can go to ACDC Video Studio 3, you may be knowing about Camtasia. Camtasia is one of the powerful software for video editing, but this is a paid software. You know, you need to purchase it, but it is one of the wonderful, powerful softwares. However, till today, you just immediately proceed to this site. Yeah, it offers by noon Pacific time there. Download it for free. Its features are nearly similar to just simply send your, type your email. It will send you its installation key and the download link. And you download it. It is a full featured platform for video editing. Now for video capture, there are some tools, both offline as well as online. OBS is there. The open broadcasting software, but there may be certain learning curve, which is open source, but there may be some learning curve with you. If you want to use easy one, then there is Screencast-O-Matic. You can go, it is online. It allows you to record your own camera plus screen using in these three modes, only the screen, only the webcam of the teacher and the webcam as well as the teacher for both. But personally, I like a utility which is very, very small. And I have told it to many people and now they are using it like anything. There is no time restriction or something. It's only 20 MB file download. It is called as FreeCam. The only thing that it won't record your video. But if you want to record your PPT presentation there along with your voice, it will go there and you can add it. You can simply hear. Fix your area which you want to screen record and go into it. Otherwise, there are certain tools like Loom is there, which you can say for Chrome extension or your Firefox extension. By recording your screen, it will show you something there, and your video, your other thing, it can be recording. There are many, many software which are used for that. Now, before we close, I have opened so many links for you. Okay. Now, if I have to share these links with you, because I know that you could not keep pace with me, let me see, there is some question. But free cam records the noise of the laptop fan. No, it is not necessary. I have used it. So there is no means. Unless if there is, even OBS Studio, you use the noise reducer there. I know that it is the inbuilt feature into it. But then you can use it. It depends on if you want to use it, the easy tool or from where. So I want to show you this, it is called as one tab extension for add-on for Firefox or for Google Chrome. You can, you know, install it. Here, and if you install it, okay, enable it. Actually, I had installed it, but then I disabled it. So here, and you can see now the one tab has come here on my browser. Now, what do? You have so many of these open tabs on your screen. And suppose during your research, you visit many, many pages, and sometimes it becomes difficult for you to keep safe. Either you keep on copy pasting, or even I know that some of you may be saying that we can bookmark them. It's okay, you can bookmark them. But then bookmark is your browser based. It stays in here. Then you can say that we have social bookmarking. I know that Digo is there, Delicious is there from where. But here it gives you a listing. If you click on now, after you activate it, if you simply click on one tab, and it will create all those resources today, which I have showed to you. All these are here. Now what I can do, I can simply save this, share this with you in the chat. And here, okay. Then or we can share them. So this is the link. Paste, it is coming here. You can click on this and then you can access all these links which I have showed it to you. So now I'm stopping my screen and check if there are any questions, or we want to have. Okay, controlling the Zoom, please let me know if any help is required. Nice to see. Thank you, Vinod. How many times it will be going on? Muhammad Ali Karim was a. Okay. Yeah. Any questions? Yeah. You know, you can unmute your mic, or you can type into the chat box.
Sir, till now we don't have any queries from our participants. I think actually what to say, sir, you are just a plethora of knowledge, and we are just taking the bits of knowledge from you and collecting all the information. Our page is full of information, so we are writing all the things. I think jotting down the points, all the participants have forgot what to ask. Actually, it's really very nice experience, and we have learned many things, means many new things which we can apply in our online teaching learning. And the things is that we are also going to introduce LMS. We are preparing for that. So the things which you have given us, it's means lots of information which we can apply actually in our online teaching learning platform. And we'll be happy if some participants ask some questions.
I have a question.
Yes.
Madam, yeah, this is Shravanti Chaudhary from Netaji Subhash Open University. Okay. And I am right now working as an assistant professor in sociology. So it is a big thanks to Sir Professor Sharma, who's really enlightened us on all the different media, I think, which we can use for online training and online class conducting. And he spoke about the narrative media, interactive media, communicative media, productive and reproductive media. And he spoke about all the animation, simulations, emails, and all sorts of social media which we can use or which we can make use of while taking online classes. My question is, first of all, sir, can we use these media one by one, or is it a mixed method approach where we can use the collage of all the five media which you have suggested to to make the class more engaging and invigorating for the students? That is my number one thing. Sir, number two, I think I have been depositing my assignments, uploading all my class streaming and the homeworks on the Google Classroom. I find it quite useful. So do you think Google Classroom is otherwise a very diluted media of taking classes, or is it, or you think usually in our university we have almost 2,000 or 300 students, I mean 200 or 300 students who come to our online classes. So and one limitation which I find with Google Classroom is that beyond 250 students, it becomes difficult to accommodate them in the Google Classroom. So in that case, sir, what should be your suggestion? Should I continue with the Google Classroom or Endemol or other things which you suggested? So these are the two questions I have. One is, can we use the collage of all the media that you suggested? And secondly, is it okay to go with Google Classroom for a capacity of 250 students? Thank you, sir.
Okay, the first, actually both these questions, they are very important. And thanks for asking, because this situation may be with other friends also who are attending this session. My answer to your first question is that it depends on your learning outcomes and the assessment activities. On the basis of that, you need to take a decision that which of these interactive media, what kind of platform, what kind of technology you are going to implement it. It's simply, there is no, open kind of rule about it. You first need to see that what is the learning outcome of your content, whether it is a complete course or a program or a unit, small unit, and how you are going to measure that learning outcome. Once you are aware of those things, then we fit in. Now, after this great success of, I'm sure maybe some of you must have enrolled in my course on cooperative learning strategy, which we very recently conducted it into there. After that, I received many requests from the colleagues, ki sir, ek mukh hume bhi banana hai, ki hum aapke saath kaam kar sakte hain. And I say that, okay, you are welcome, but please do one thing. My advice to them is, first of all, if you want to do it, create a TOC, table of contents. Because you need to be first sure that what you are going to cover. Once you are ready with your TOC, table of contents, then go for making a mind map or concept map about it. Because it gives you a clarity about the hierarchy, what you will be following that. Once you are clear of that, then you can imagine your learning outcomes. And learning outcomes will then give you a guidance that how you are going to align your learning, your assessment strategies with those learning outcomes. To fulfill those, then we need to decide whether it will be a discussion forum will be there, or we need to have some sort of a audio-based assessment or a practical-based assessment or field-based assessment or pen and paper kind, what kind that will fit into there. So that is the answer, that there is no, it means we need to, it is not that, it is quite subjective in nature. It will differ from situation to situation. So first is that. The second is about Google Classroom. Google Classroom is available to us in two varieties. One, through our personal Gmail ID. You can use it from there also. And another is through G Suite account. Now, G Suite account is the Google application package, which is free of cost. You can download it from there, but ask your IT department to install it on university servers. Now, what is the benefit of that? If you are using normal Google Classroom there, when a student submits an assignment, it won't do the similarity check, the plagiarism check, which is available only in the G Suite ID from there. And similarly, the Google Meet, which is a part of that, Gmail now. In normal, through your personal Google account, you can have hundreds participants into it, and in that 250 participants through that. But that is for web conferencing. Google Meet is for web conferencing. Okay. The Google Classroom is the learning management system, although I consider it as content management system. It is designated as LMS also, but keeping in view its limited capabilities. Although, and there is, means you can create a rubric which allows you as a teacher to guide, to evaluate properly, and it becomes a guideline for the students also to let them know that if they have to explain something, if they have to attempt their assignment, how they will be doing it, because the rubric is there. So my advice is that keep continuing with Google Classroom. It is a good platform. There is nothing wrong into it. The only challenge with Google Classroom has, as compared to other LMS like Moodle, if I say the name Moodle, then in Moodle, you have lot of varieties of activities and assessments which can go into there as compared to Google Classroom. But otherwise, it's a wonderful platform. In my university, we have both these things. I have given training to both the people. And perhaps in one of my screen, when I was changing, you saw my Google Classroom platform. I have many classes, the real live classes, not only for my own university. I am a co-teacher in a course of a real live course of biotechnology of a college of Delhi University. And there they are using Google Classroom with all the students. And they have passed their examination also. The teacher, I assisted her for online assessment, online examination, and that was done by them. I think there is some question about online question. Gopal is asking.
Yes, sir. There are question from Ibrahim Hussain Sheikh. He want to know about what app can be easier for online teaching for new teacher of the field. Actually, online teaching is something new for the teachers of regular mode due to this pandemic. So he want to ask which app will be easier for online teaching, direct online teaching.
So the question needs to be put in this way. Means there is no app for teaching as such.
Okay.
You know, we have app for certain either tool or a platform. If you want to mount your content, then you have various apps or various learning management systems. If you want to teach your students online, then you have apps for, say, for example, you have Zoom app, you have Google Meet to be installed on your mobile device. So these are the web conferencing tools. Now, if you are thinking that you want to teach your students in a synchronous mode, then all these apps, they have their own challenges with you. Perhaps on the basis of my own experience, I have found that Zoom is the best. Means whatever the people will say, ke wo Zoom ke andar chori ho jayega, it steals your data or something. I believe that it depends on us, what information we are sharing through that. Means nowadays, there is a challenge going on perhaps on Facebook, and please don't beat me up. I think it's more popular among the ladies. The challenge is something like it is asking you to have your childhood photo and your current photo and paste them side by side and share with the all. Now, who is asking you to share all your photographs? Means we ourselves are offering our data first to Mark Zuckerberg, and from here it will go to Cambridge Analytica, and then any person can do it. So that way, otherwise so in terms of tools, perhaps you need to think your purpose. If you are clear of your purpose, then we have various applications. I suggest that if you can go to my slide share account, there I have a complete presentation, which I last year when I went to Peru, there was an international conference in Lima. I had made a presentation there on the mobile-based learning pedagogy and various kind of apps which we can use in there. If it is there, otherwise I can pass it on to Dr. Indrani, And if you have your WhatsApp group, it can be shared in there. So don't worry, I can share it with all of you.
Okay, sir. One more question from our colleague, Ritimani Bordoloi. She stated, as we know that there is UNESCO OER policy, how we proceed for making or producing OERs in regional languages, basically in Assamese, because in Assam we need in Assamese, as it is one of the best ways for providing academic support to the learner at the present situation. How we translate the OERs to regional language?
Very good question. Today in the morning at 10:30 a.m., I had a meeting with Dr. Wayne McIntosh. Perhaps you all know him, the founder of Wiki Educator, the chairman of OER Foundation, Dr. Wayne McIntosh, today. And we, due to this UNESCO recommendations, very recent, that this the OER resources may be developed in regional languages also. We are going ahead first with Hindi version of the most popular course of OERF about OER, copyright, and that course. So, and we there, we have suggested to him that first we are, this meeting happened today only at 10:30. And once we are successful with our experiment, then, so the answer to your question that how we can do it, the OE Wiki Educator, they have developed a platform on which various languages they are supported. So just as you can edit a wiki page, you can just contribute your content into Bengali or means the Assamese or Garo, Khasi, those languages which are, you know, more popular in Northeast, and add to the content. But it depends. I think it supports Bengali. I know about it because the Bengali Wiki media is a very strong page. And I think Rajiv Datta is my friend. He's from West Bengal. He is a very prominent Wiki author in Bengali on that. So the platform is getting ready, and very soon you all will be able to contribute your content on it.
Thank you, sir. I think we have almost covered, and you have almost covered all the topics which we
Sangeeta,
have suggested.
Just yes? Sangeeta is asking, effective platform for conducting online examination. Okay, for this online examination, I will have various, suggestions. And I think in my university, I gave a proposal. Look, it depends on what resource you have. Accordingly, you can go. You say that the places where network issue is there, definitely if it is an online examination, some net connectivity is required. Now, it may be the case that strong network or low network. If it is a low network, then you can create your examination using Google Form, which is easy to create, and you can make it a time bound that at particular time it will open. At one particular time, there are widgets for like Timeify, T-I-M-E-F-Y something, Timeify. This is an extension for Google Forms, which will time control the Google quiz. You need to make it as a Google quiz. But otherwise, or through your LMS, you can make all kind of online examinations. Other than that, there are other platforms. Like you have Go Formative, it is one word, Go Formative. There you can create all kind of objective type, subjective type, essay type examination. All this can be created using that platform. Then you have Socrative, and its app is also very popular, Socrative. If you want to go for gamify kind of online examination, then we have quizzes, quizizizz.com, quizzes.com, or maybe Kahoot, you must have heard many of you. And those things, they are, you know, used by many people. So it depends on what resource you have. Then there are various, we call them as safe browsers. So like Respondus, if you go to web now, R-E-S-P-O-N-D-U-S, Respondus, there. This is a browser, means a safe browser kind, which controls something. If you have Chromebook with you, you know, the netbook of Chromebook there. So their browser also locks. It locks you. You won't be able to surf any other website once that browser is open, something like there. So there are various means and strategies available to us where we can take care of these things. Is there any question? You can check it.
I think there are no more questions, sir. Yes, one question given by Gopal Barman, sir. What kind of alternative assessment and evaluation can be appropriate for online education system? What kind of alternative assessment and evaluation can be appropriate for online education system?
What kind of
appropriate? What kind of alternative assessment and evaluation can be appropriate for online education?
Nowadays, during our multinational research, what we found that the formative kind of assessment is a good alternate assessment. Because we can't ask our students to gather now and have some sort of a proctor kind of examination, which is a summative kind of examination. So the alternative assessments nowadays, which can be easily conducted using online platforms are giving them some activity and getting it assessed in the form of peer assessment. And peer assessment can be as easily as a discussion forum. In your learning management system, you have discussion forum and you can ask the people to rate the answer of others. So they grade each other and then you can ask them to justify their grade also, because it increases their critical evaluation from there. And then through short quizzes, through like H5P, I showed it to you, those kind of activities, the interactive plus inbuilt into it from there, fun with learn, that also promotes them. So it depends on the age group, but definitely the alternate nowadays in this situation, many of the countries they have shifted to the formative assessment situation.
Thank you so much, sir. I think there might be many queries, but the thing is that we have to end up somewhere, and the
I can keep answering.
We will be very happy by asking you a question, but the thing is that we have to, it's the rule of our your workshop or seminar, anything, we have to end up somewhere. But we are very
One more thing, because Dulal Chandra Karmakar has raised an issue. Most of the students hail from rural areas and they have poor network connectivity. Okay. Just for that, I want to show you one thing, and perhaps my screen sharing is disabled. Vinod, can you activate my screen sharing, please?
Done, sir.
Okay. I want to show one thing which may be interesting for all of you. This is called as Moodle Box. You know, open source software, and similarly, as we have open source software, we have open source hardware. Okay, like Elon Musk, he has released the patent of his electric car. Anybody who wants to make electric car can take the design diagrams, the technology of Elon Musk of electric car, and can make electric car. Similarly, Moodle, they have this Moodle box, which is based on Raspberry, hardware, and on the basis of that, this doesn't require the normal kind of internet. Means within the vicinity of this, and this is free. Means they don't sell it, but they have the technology, and its cost is around $90. So that is not expensive at all. And once you activate it, then the mobile devices within certain range of it, it becomes as a hotspot, and then you can upload on a memory stick whole of your encyclopedia, whole of your Moodle, and your other course material into it. So under these circumstances, this kind of an alternative, you can try it. I have shown you the website. You can go there and can find more information. Okay, Indrani, let me not hold you back, because every time you try to close it.
No, sir. It's okay. Thank you so much, sir. And we are really very much delighted to hear you and such a valuable speech. And I don't know about others, but I have collected lots of information. I don't know what I will apply in my field, but I have collected within this period of time, I have collected lots of information. I hope all of our participants have also collected lots of information which they will apply in the field of education, hopefully, in the coming this pandemic area, after pandemic also. And Thank you so much. Means we are just speechless. What to say, sir? In a very short span, you have given such a full of information. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you very much for giving us this transparent and time.
Yes, one
sir.
Question from that will be last. have you installed Moodle in university there? Are you working on Moodle or some other LMS?
Yes, Moodle, sir. We have installed Moodle, sir.
Okay, let me all of you show you one thing which my friends they have developed, and again please share my screen because this will be very good for everyone. And you I will pass on their email ID to you. They will send you the code to allow you to download it. Okay, just I want to show every one of you. That is called as feedback fruits. This is we are installing it on our Moodle, and already my three friends, one in AKTU, that is Abdul Kalam Technological University in UP, which has more than 65,000 students on their roll, and they are using Moodle in their course. This is a very good, you know, a tool for feedback to be given. And I have seen there, you can book a demo. This is wonderful. Means the kind of feedback which you can give to your students on their content, on their instructions, on their discussions, that is very, very much, this is a wonderful thing. And currently they are, you know, kind enough to give it free of cost if you can install it on their on your Moodle. So you can have it, and now it is available in Microsoft Teams also. You can find it from there. So you can surf this website. This will be good for all of you. This is about feedback to be given, and feedback is very important for our students, because only then we can enhance their learning. We conduct their examination, we assess their assignments, and then if we don't give, and particularly we are now as in open university system, we know that there are 8 kind of comments: follow comments, negative comments, positive comment, encouraging comments, and like that. But in the assignment, if you just write good, it doesn't serve any purpose. What is good? What was good? We need to tell that. This software means gives a wonderful platform for having that kind of feedback enabled on our own content. So please go for that. And now you can close. Okay, now I will keep quiet.
Hello, Dr. Indrani.
Yes.
So may I permit to give the announcement?
Yes, of course.
Yes. I request all participants tomorrow at 2:30 session, our resource person Ajit Kumar from IGNU, he will present it on a topic asynchronous and synchronous communication tools. So he requested all participants to be in the session with their laptop or desktop, whatever it may be. And he gives some software to be downloaded. I post it in our WhatsApp group so that they can download all the softwares he wish to be with every participant's laptop. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Shakya. Thank you. Formally, I'm thanking you, sir, after such a long session. And I just don't want that this is the last session with us. I want you to be with us again more and more session for more and more session in near future. And we want your support, we want your help to make our online learning successful, even in Assam, because in Assam you know it is not very easy to make it successful. So we need your help, we need your support, and we need your feedback always how to make the online learning an effective one in Assam also. Thank you so much, sir. And thank you very much to give your consent in a very short period. And you have given such a nice presentation. And I think all our participants are very much fruitful with your presentation. So thank you so much. A last announcement for our, bye-bye, sir. Last announcement for our participant. We will be happy if you join with our second session today, though the time is quite late, but by 8 p.m. today, because our speaker is from USA. So we'll be thankful if you kindly join for our next session. Thank you. Thank you so much, sir, and thank you to all participants. Bye, bye, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Bye, everyone. Bye, take care.
Thank you, sir. Yeah.